Hi, friends of the planet. Miro here. I am so thrilled that we are joined today by Dr. Neil Vora, who is a physician and an epidemiologist and is the current pandemic prevention fellow at Conservation International. So Dr. Vora, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us today.
Thank you for having me.
And I wanted to ask, throughout your career, you have studied and responded to several infectious diseases. And could you talk to us a bit about how the destruction of nature has been a common theme among these various responses that you've had to attend to?
The data are very clear that since at least the 1940s, new infectious diseases have been on the rise. And most of these new infectious diseases originate from animals. In fact, when I was in medical school, I've always wanted to get into conservation, and I was struggling to link environmental health, human health, and animal health. And I read this paper in 2007, and I had an epiphany when I read it because it showed very clearly exactly this point, that emerging infectious diseases are on the rise, most come from animals. And a light bulb went off in my head that I could, for the first time, see how our health as humans is linked to the health of animals and the planet. And the list of new infectious diseases or very severe infectious diseases that have animal origins is really profound. Everything from Ebola to SARS, so the original SARS coronavirus, to Zika, probably back in the 1940s, that then spilled over into people, and many others. And also, it's very likely the case that COVID, the virus that causes COVID, also originated from animals. It's the destruction of nature, in particular clearing of rainforests, degradation of rainforests, that are putting humans in close contact with wildlife and creating those opportunities for the viruses to jump over. The other thing I would also mention is the wildlife trade has a huge impact on transmission of infectious diseases, and it's actually creating the conditions that lead to pathogen spillover from those wildlife to humans.
What kind of immediate steps could we take to prevent these types of pandemics going forward by protecting nature?
We have to think about setting up a reformed global health architecture that also includes true prevention of pandemics. And that means thinking about what is driving the increasing pace of pathogen spillover from wildlife into people. And so I would say that there's primarily three categories of activities that need to be addressed to prevent that pathogen spillover in the future. Category one is tropical forests and how we interact with them, in particular, addressing deforestation and forest degradation. Bucket number two is the wildlife trade. So stopping the wildlife trade, both legal and illegal, that contributes to pathogen spillover, right? Because there are some forms of the illegal wildlife trade that contribute to pathogen spillover, and also some forms of legal wildlife trade that lead to pathogen spillover. And the third bucket that's also extremely important is animal husbandry. In particular, the intensive rearing of livestock can create conditions that allow for pathogen spillover from wildlife into those domestic animals, causing outbreaks in those domestic animals. And also from those domestic animals, humans can then get infected. So we need to increase biosecurity around intensive livestock rearing.
I wanted to dive into that last point you made a little bit more, because we've seen infectious diseases in the past, even in my lifetime, emerge from industrial animal agriculture. But what specific steps could we take to minimize the risk of, you know, new pandemics coming out of our food systems?
You're entirely right. There are a number of very significant outbreaks that have happened in the setting of intensive animal husbandry. In particular, influenza viruses can circulate in crowded conditions, and the different influenza viruses can mix with each other, leading to the emergence of new influenza viruses. And so that is a major concern. You know, it's not really my area of expertise to talk specifically about the biosecurity around agriculture and animal husbandry. So I don't want to go into there and mislead anyone. But the point I'm trying to make is that we do know intensive animal husbandry can create the conditions for spillover. And that's not to say that animal husbandry is bad, certainly not, because in many instances, humans rely on domestic animals for our nutrition and for many other reasons. But what I am saying is that we need to take steps to improve biosecurity around farms so that we can reduce the chances of pathogen spillover into those domestic animals and into humans.
That's a really important point of prevention. And diving into my next question, do you think that governments on both a national and sub-national level are focusing too much of their attention on pandemic preparedness and not enough on pandemic prevention in the first place?
I'm very optimistic that even at the highest levels of government, we are now seeing calls for a reformed global health architecture to prevent future pandemic deaths. And that means that we need to invest in three categories of activities: pandemic prevention, pandemic preparedness, and pandemic response. Pandemic prevention refers to avoiding a pandemic in the first place. Preparedness means getting ready for all the things we need to do once that pandemic does occur. And pandemic response is the actual steps that we need to take to address a pandemic when it's at our doorsteps. The unfortunate thing, despite those calls for a reformed global health architecture, too often I'm seeing that the dominant global health voices are forgetting about pandemic prevention. And there are examples with this. The WHO, the World Health Organization, recently convened an independent panel, and the panel's name is the Independent Panel for Pandemic Preparedness and Response. But they don't even mention the word prevention in the name of that panel. And in their 86-page report, there is really no recommendations on preventing pathogen spillover, right? So these are missed opportunities because we cannot rely just on preparedness and response as the only measures for avoiding future pandemics. By that, I mean that there's going to be a future pathogen that will emerge, that will surprise us, that will be able to outsmart our conventional public health approaches. And that's why we can't rely on responding to outbreak after outbreak and responding to pandemics. We actually have to prevent them from happening in the first place. And so we hope that through advocacy from both public health groups and environmental groups, we can get more attention placed on the importance of prevention of pathogen spillover as a means of preventing pandemics.
For those of us who are not epidemiologists or doctors, I think in our day-to-day lives, we've had a crash course in pandemics and infectious disease and kind of our personal response to it as individuals, as families, as households. But I wanted to ask, because you were involved in New York City's response to COVID-19, what have been your biggest takeaways as an expert from this pandemic that you would like more people to be aware of? I know that's a broad question, but we'd love to hear your thoughts.
So for the last year I oversaw, before I joined Conservation International, I oversaw New York City's COVID contact tracing program. And so we had a team of over 3,000 contact tracers, and it was a huge program. And it was also a huge privilege to oversee in an operation like that. Personally, it meant a lot to me because my dad actually had smallpox as a child, and it was the work of contact tracers around the world in the 60s and 70s that led to the eradication of smallpox. You know, I've been involved in so many outbreak responses, not just to COVID, but also to Ebola. I was in West Africa and in Central Africa for the two largest Ebola outbreaks ever. I've responded to pox viruses, rabies, measles, a number of other outbreaks in the 9 years I was with CDC. Every outbreak that I've responded to, except for one, however, has been the result of spillover from an animal into people of that virus or that pathogen. And that underscores the importance of having a comprehensive approach to public health. We cannot just think about humans, even if the goal is to save human lives. You have to think about it broadly if we really want to have a system that saves as many lives as possible. And that means also thinking about the health of animals and the health of the planet. And that's why I made the very difficult decision to leave the CDC, an agency that I love, but I made that decision so that I could join Conservation International to help address the underlying drivers that lead to pathogen spillover. And so the lesson I would say is that we know from COVID and from so many other outbreaks, we have to connect the health of humans to the health of the planet on which we live. And I hope that, you know, as we recover from COVID, we are going to incorporate the planet, including nature and all the animals that live on the planet, into our Build Back Better efforts.
I think that's such a wonderful takeaway and another reminder that the health of humans is completely dependent on the health of nature and the health of our planet. And we need to be aware of that. I know there are some opportunities for the world to get together to make some more stringent commitments later this year, whether it's the conversations that are going to happen around biodiversity protection and around the Glasgow conversations. So Dr. Vora, before we let you go, I wanted to ask, could you make the connection to us between conservation and public health? I know that may not be obvious to a lot of people, but there are a lot of connections there.
I would say that conservation is public health. It took me some time to make that connection, but I was listening to an interview by one of the former administrators of the Environmental Protection Agency, and that administrator made the point that the EPA is a public health agency. At that moment, I realized that everything that is done in conservation comes back to public health because people need nature to survive. We cannot live without the planet and all of the amazing resources that the planet provides us. So beyond infectious diseases, which has been the focus of our conversation today, there are so many benefits to humans of the work that conservationists do. When you look at work to preserve oceans or for biodiversity or for climate change, and the list goes on and on. But conservation is public health, and we really have to continue to emphasize the connection between those two fields so that people do not think that conservation is just about saving cute furry animals and trees in other parts of the world.
And, you know, I feel like we could talk to you all day. I have so many questions, but are there any parting thoughts you'd like to leave us with before we go?
Again, I just want to emphasize that we have an opportunity with a very limited amount of time before the world moves on to the next crisis, but we have this opportunity to reform the global health architecture. And that means that we have to incorporate pandemic prevention in addition to pandemic preparedness and response. It's not that one is more important than the other. They are all absolutely important because we're never going to completely eliminate pathogen spillover from wildlife into people. And that's why preparedness and response are always going to play a role. But also preparedness and response are not the only ways that we are going to reduce human deaths from a future pandemic, because there's going to be some future pathogen that will surprise us. And that's why we need to prevent that spillover in the first place, so we don't have to even experience that infectious disease in the first place. So they're all really important. And now is the opportunity to bring all these different disciplines together, from human health and public health and veterinary medicine and ecology and mammalogy. The list goes on and on and on. But we have to all work together, because we'll need an all-of-government approach to address the next pandemic.
Indeed, just like we need an all-of-government approach to address climate change and so many other issues. Dr. Vora, thank you so much for your time, for your expertise. We really hope to have you back on here soon.
Thank you so much.